Welcome on behalf of Dr. Darnell Hunt and Alex Tucker. I welcome all of you here to the Ralph J. Bunche Center for African American Studies. Today we're here to talk about the life and the career of Stepin Fetchit, Lincoln Monroe Perry. We are doing a weekend called the Reexamination of the Black Image in Mass Media, and we have Stepin Fetchit and this brilliant, brilliant book written by Mel Watkins as the centerpiece of the weekend. Also, the play will be... where is it, Mel? What's the name of the play? I'm just lost the name of the play. The Confessions of Stepin Fetchit, written by Matt Robinson, will be performed this weekend at the Nate Holden Performing Arts Center, starring in a one-man play, Mr. Roscoe Orman. So I'd like to welcome all of you here today. We'd like to begin with introducing the panelists on the end. Before that, Miles, you must forgive me. I have just been really concussively impacted by the presence of a man who's here today. And this is the firstborn son of Lincoln Perry. His name is Jamaju Joseph Perry, and he's here today. And sir, we'd like to welcome you. I mean, there have been so many rumors about his life, about his death, and I'm so pleased to see that he's among the land of the living, because we did not know, and we're very happy that you're here today. But I'd like to begin by introducing, on the end to my left, Mr. Miles Kruger, who is a dear friend, and he is, in my estimation, and the world suggested as well, the definitive historian on the history of the American musical in theater and on film. He is a founder of the Institute of the American Musical here in Los Angeles. It started in New York City, but he's presently here in Los Angeles, and he's written the book on Showboat, the story of a classic American musical. Would you please welcome Mr. Miles Kruger. Sitting to his right, the professor of African-American expressive culture, philosophy, and linguistics at UC Riverside, please welcome Dr. Boris L. Nunley. To his right, for 32 years, he's played Gordon on Sesame Street. You've seen him on Broadway, if you were in New York, to see it during his time with Billy Williams in Fences. But he's here performing The Confessions of Stepin Fetchit for three performances over the weekend. Please welcome Mr. Roscoe Orman. And certainly the reason why I'm here today is because of this great book, Stepin Fetchit, The Life and Times of Lincoln Perry, written by a gentleman who wrote an extraordinary book called On the Real Side, The History of African American Humor. For many, many years, he was at the New York Times as a book editor and book critic. But he's here today to talk about, with great specificity, his present book, Stepin Fetchit, The Life and Times of Lincoln Perry. Please welcome the august author, Mr. Mel Watkins. Unfortunately, Dr. Hunt couldn't be here with you today, and so I'm here to function somewhat as a moderator, but not really, because I really believe it's going to be a wonderful discussion among these men on the panel and all of you. And so when we get to the Q&A session, I'm hopeful that you would participate as liberally as you desire. So I'd like to begin with Mr. Mel Watkins to just talk about the impetus for your writing this book.
Okay. Well, as you mentioned, about 10 years ago, right, 1994, I published a book called On the Real Side, The History of African American Comedy. At that time, it was a much longer title of this book. Laughing, something signifying that I've forgotten what on it ever. And in fact, the front page of the book could hardly hold the entire title, and many people who reviewed it declined to put in the subtitle since it was so long. It was a suggestion of my editor, Simon Schuster, at that time. The book later came out. It was simply named On the Real Side, A History of African American Comedy, which I think is much more succinct, and we can get our hands around it. While I was doing research on that book, I discovered Stepin Fetchit. But let me step back one moment. The reason I got into doing research on that book, I'm very much thinking of Richard Pryor or something, because the reason I did or got into African American comedy, the reason I decided to analyze and try to figure out where it came from and what the sources were, was because of Richard Pryor. So starting with Richard Pryor, that was the first inspiration for my getting into writing about comedy, because I felt that Richard Pryor was saying more about the African American situation than many writers at that time. And at the time I did that book, I was at the New York Times. And I was dealing with writers like Toni Morrison and Alvin Murray and Bradley and the various writers, Alice Walker and so forth. All of these famous writers who were around in the late 60s and 70s and early 80s. I thought that Richard Pryor was adding something to what they said. I thought that it was that much of a social trick. I thought that he was bold enough to say things that they were almost afraid to say in their novels. So that started me to thinking, well, you know, the comic can do this. What's this about? Where did it come from? What's the history of this stuff? And that's why I wrote On the Real Side. Now, doing research on the Real Side, I ran into a dozen memorable characters, Pippi Marco, Dusty Fletcher, Mom's Neighbor, Butter Beans and Susie, Bert Williams, a guy named Billy Curzons, Ernest Hogan, a guy who wrote a song called All Coons Look Alike to Me. All these characters started to jump out at me, and I was fascinated by many of them. But the one that really caught my attention was Stepin Fetchit, because he appeared to me to be somewhat of an enigma. I didn't really know where to put him. Everything I read about him was negative, and yet when I started to get a little bit below the surface about this character, I discovered that this was the distortion. This man was much more complex, much more interesting than what the press and what subsequent critical analysis would have led me to believe. So I got deeper into it. I went into, basically, my book is based on reports from the black press, because the mainstream press, I felt, could not be trusted. First of all, I thought that Stepin Fetchit or Lincoln Perry was deceiving the mainstream press in most of the statements that he made. He was playing a certain kind of game, and I felt that most of what was said about him in the mainstream press was a distortion. The black press, on the other hand, was giving a somewhat truer picture. And beyond that, I discovered that he had written for the Chicago Defender at a certain point, that he was a part of the black press. He was a voice in that press. So I found that those reports gave me a better idea of who he was. And I had done some research and been doing it on the Real Side. I've met people like John Bubbles of Bucking Bubbles, who knew Steph. I met a few other people who knew him. I ran into a friend of my ex-wife, in fact, who lived in the same building that Stepin Fetchit lived in when he lived in Harlem. She knew him as a child when he was going, at that point, to see the woman, Winnie Johnson, that he reportedly married, and his second son was with that woman. So that there were all these connections that were coming out, and I started discovering more and more about him, and I decided, okay, this man is ripe for a book. Somebody needs to try to tell something about him and place it in context to show his significance as a film pioneer and also the complexity of the man. And that is how the book got started, and that's what we have there before us. I hope that I was able to do it in a way that was interesting, or at least certainly to place him in context, to make us step back and say, okay, this is what they thought then. We should take a different view of this, because those times are gone. And to me, Stepin Fetchit reflects more about the history of America, about the racial arrangements of that time, than he does about being an Uncle Tom, being a negative influence in the films. I think he should be heralded and recognized and celebrated as the pioneer that he was.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Mel. You know, it's interesting you talk about him because he was a pioneer. And he made a statement in 1967. He said that I walked through the back door so that Sidney Poitier could walk through the front door. And it was very interesting and ironic that in 1967, Mr. Poitier was the number one box office star in the world. He had three major motion pictures that, you know, represented the number one box office star in the world, not just our country. So that's really fascinating. And he really pays proper homage to Lincoln Perry. The fact that he stands today even on his shoulders. Roscoe Orman, let's talk about your involvement. You've been involved now for 13 years with the play The Confessions of Stepin Fetchit. What attracted you to the character? What attracted Matt Robinson, the writer, the father of Holly Robinson Peete? Matt wrote this play, The Confessions of Stepin Fetchit. Can you just talk about, through your dialogue with Matt and your director, Bill Layton, and your own personal journey in finding Lincoln Perry in such a way that you would honor him through your beautiful performance?
Sure. Well, I just had the incredible good fortune of knowing Matt Robinson pretty well. Many people may not remember that Matt was the original Gordon on Sesame Street, actually. His daughter Holly mentions that quite a bit when she's a Matt was a wonderful writer and producer in television and film. And in 1974, he produced and wrote a film called Amazing Grace as a vehicle for Mom's Maybe. And in the course of shooting the film, Mom's and Slappy White, another cast member, brought a friend of theirs to a set one day and introduced him as Stepin Fetchit. Matt Robinson, and Matt nearly fell over when heard that this was the one and only. He had not been in a film since, I think, the early 50s. Bend of the River was his last film to that point. Matt and Steph, as everyone called them, became pretty good friends immediately. They really hit it off, became quite close, and Mr. Perry told him his life story quite a number of times, told him all kinds of things about who he really was and what his story symbolized from his perspective. And Matt eventually turned that story, as told by him, into this play called Confessions of Stepin Fetchit. In 1991 or 92, I was at a function with Matt, he said, you know what, Oscar, I just realized I have something for you. I have something I'd like for you to read. I'll send it to you in the mail. And about 2 days later, I got this package with this script, Confessions of Stepin Fetchit. Now, up to that point, I had not really had much knowledge about the real Stepin Fetchit. I grew up in the 40s and 50s, and by then, his career was pretty much over. I guess I'd maybe seen clips of some of his films. Nothing really memorable, but his name did stand out as more of a term of derision used by many of our people in the African American community as a way of putting down someone. Oh, you're just a Stepin Fetchit, something that we should kind of look down. When I read the play, it was a revelation to me to realize that this man was such an incredible artist as a performer. Also, a very intelligent, ambitious, and motivated individual who had a life and a personality much beyond and much different from the persona that was seen on the film. So it became a very intriguing on stage. Fortunately, through my director, Bill Lathan, and Matt, we were able to get production mounted in 1993 at the American Place Theater in New York City, which ran for 6 weeks, and we got wonderful critical response from the establishment in New York City, great audience response. The only people who really seemed not to have responded well to the idea of the play were those who didn't come to see it. Because just the idea in their minds of doing a play that supposedly glorifies the image of this man who was held in such low esteem and such shame is something that they thought was shameful in itself. This was something that we really should not be doing. In other words, their image of him was so profoundly negative that they could not envision how or why we would want to give him this kind of attention and honor and appreciation. And of course, Mel's work both on the real side, which I used as a vital resource in terms of my study of America, understanding the context of those times. Mel, in this book, and of course, Stepin Fetchit, reveals even more of the details of his time and his life. So, I'm really very happy for my good fortune in that I was able to kind of just fall into this. I also discovered that before we even mounted the play that there was somewhat of a family connection. My late aunt, Cora Lee Day, was an actress. My daughter's she was the matriarch. She told me some stories about Penny and Perry as a family friend of her mother, my grandmother, my father's mother. She and Lincoln were born in the same year, 1902, in Key West, Florida, and lived across the street from each other, and remained lifelong friends. My Aunt Cora and my father, Roscoe Sr., knew him as children, as Uncle Step. So that really kind of made me feel a special connection to the man and the story. And I promised my Aunt Cora that I would do justice to his image. I would do my best. She really was not only a fan of his, but really loved him as a man. So it's just been an honor all through.
Well, thank you, Roscoe. Just as a means of backstory, my great-grandfather, Willis Handy Young, and all four of my grandparents were on POVA Lincoln Perry. So I knew them through the generation, if you will. And so one day, I went to Esalon Bookstore, represented here today by James Hughgate, one of its owners, and Vanessa from Esalon Books, and I purchased the book, and I read it immediately. I read it, and it was very impactful, and so I said, you know, I'm going to make a cold call to New York City. I'm calling this Mel Watkins. And so I phoned him, and we had a conversation, and I shared with him some of my background and some of the things I'd been up to recently in theater and television and film, and we had a really wonderful conversation. And then, as it turns out, he had a conversation maybe 4 days later, 3 or 4 days later, with Roscoe. Roscoe had read the book. And Roscoe called me, and we talked about it. So that became the impetus for this whole weekend, re-examining the black image in mass media. And so I said, listen, Mel, I'd like for you to come out to do a book signing. I'd like to host you. I'd like the theatrical community of Los Angeles to come out and really hear you. And Roscoe, we came together. And so that's how I became, I guess I conceived and I'm producing this weekend, born of that dynamic. And my grandfather, Troy Brown, fifth black actor in the Screen Actors Guild, I got this material that in June 1st, 1940, in the Baltimore Afro-American, it said, replaces Stepin Fetchit, Troy Brown, my grandfather, 1940 on Broadway. Replaced Step twice in the musical Walk with Music with Kitty Carlisle and Mitzi Green. So the connections are really, really rather extraordinary. You know, but speaking to that, Dr. Nunley, you've addressed the issue in this society of black masculinity, African-American expressive culture. Your reading of this book, your historically knowing of Stepin Fetchit, Lincoln Perry, Hattie McDaniel, Louise Beavers, and others of that period, Willie Best and others. Would you please speak to us today about where he fits in within all that you've studied and all that you teach?
Sure. Recently, I know you're all familiar with the fact that 50 Cent, depending on whether you like them or not, two quarters, recently dropped a movie called Get Rich or Die Trying. And you're all familiar with the fact that there was this protest about the imagery of this long, gigantic billboard with one hand he was holding a baby and the other hand a gun, and another picture he was holding a microphone, he was holding a gun. Now, this is an aside, I find it interesting, there was no complaint about that until it was like on La Cienega, but that's a whole other issue, right? And so, when I thought about the debate around that, right, and it became this kind of either or, either he's to be totally dismissed, right, as a sellout, a peddler of black death, as a gangster rapper, or you're just an old head and you don't get it. And so what made me think about is this notion that Victor Hardy, who does a lot of work in African-American history, and Toni Morrison, when they say that history is not dead, it's not past. So how does that bring me to Stepin Fetchit? Frankly, I'm one of those who could understand why there was a certain amount of apropos about the way he performed. I've seen some clips, that sort of thing. And frankly, I saw this book in the bookstore, and that's the one. But then, as you know, you and I started having some conversations. Then it made me rethink about the fact that, well, isn't it interesting how certain people get reread differently in different times? So, I have to remember, initially, Zora Neale Hurston was marked as the sellout by Richard Wright. as a buffoon, as a kind of plantation in kind of nostalgically sentimental ways, invoke Cosby's, this, the Bill Cosby show, this excellent popular culture icon. But I remember when it was out, there were folks saying, that's not really black, right? And don't know black people live like that, et cetera, et cetera. So because of that, I said, okay, if I'm going to be doing this kind of work, then I need to revisit Stepin Fetchit. So that's, and I had left some of the mail's earlier works. I said, okay, let me check this out. Turns out I'm glad I did. Because, as always, there's some complicity, but there always is. But there's often some resistance. So for me, I'm going to engage in both, right? How, in some ways, he was complicit. And some would argue, well, because he was a man of his time, but Langston Hughes was of that time. Pauline Hopkins was of that time, right? And they made some different kinds of choices. On the other hand, it's real clear, right, that if Muhammad Ali values him enough, mm-hmm. that would be his entourage, right? If Phil Wilson thinks enough about his work, then there was something there. And I just think that for me, we have to be clear about the fact that what he had to wrestle with, excuse me, what he had to deal with, because if we can't understand Stepin Fetchit's time, then we can't understand Kanye West, right? Because right now, if you don't, next week he's going to be on Rolling Stone magazine as a picture of, he's going to be Christ, right? Because he feels like he's been sacrificed and he's being stoned and that sort of thing. So what I love about Mel's book is that he takes this character, and I think he really tries to flesh him out. So on one hand, we get this, a sense of his artistry, right? His brilliance, and you were talking about this earlier, right? On the other hand, he rightfully writes about how he essentially denigrated and dogged Martin Luther King and the civil rights movement, but he puts it in a particular context. So for me, I'm interested in Stepin Fetchit because what we wrestled with then, we're still wrestling with now. And if we misunderstand and misread him, then who knows, the right people will misread him now. Right now, as for instance, when you were talking on a front page and they were like railing against Stepin Fetchit, railing against him, dogging him. Yeah. Then you brought up, well, what about Ice Cube? Then it got quiet. And so that's for me how I come to this. I'm very interested in the fact that popular culture, in my view, is never merely entertainment. That's a new notion. That entertainment is not political, that it's not social, that it doesn't have social investment. And therefore, I'm interested in popular culture, expressive culture, and the history, and I don't think I can understand that without Stepin Fetchit. It was clear to me that I misunderstood a lot because there was so much misinformation out there, and I think he's done a lot to correct that, to offer a palliative to that. And so that's kind of my interest in it. How does that connect to the issues we deal with today?
Mm-hmm. Thank you. You know, it's very interesting because we're talking about the limited opportunities and, you know, the real limited. You wanted to work, particularly in that period. And, you know, when you worked in vaudeville before all black audiences, you were able to carry on in a way that you wouldn't carry on in front of white people. You just would not do that. And so when you come into motion pictures and it's, you know, all around this country, these images, and then it's a further pejorative image because we came here against our will in 1619 with an image problem right from the beginning. So as we come all the way through the transatlantic slave trade, we come through indentured servitude, we come through Reconstruction, we come through the birth of a nation, originally the Klansmen, we come through legal apartheid, Jim Crow, a minstrel character, we've had an image problem. And particularly our women have been devastated, in my estimation, nowadays, for the last 25 years, most particularly by a billionaire named Robert Johnson. So this is, you know, a part of my interest as well. And with that, I'd like to take it to Mr. Miles Kruger, who was a gentleman in New York City in 1971 who in fact saved the only nitrate print of Hearts in Dixie. So Miles, I'd like for you to speak to that rescuing effort, if you will. People rescue dogs and other things now. You rescue the film.
I also rescue dogs.
Yeah, I know that gives your attention and predilection to rescue something.
Molly is waiting at home for me.
But not only that, Miles, in Hearts of Dixie, but would you speak to, specifically having written what I feel is definitive history on Showboat, would you talk about the 1929 version versus the 1936 version? And of course, on December 27, 1927, on a Tuesday night, Showboat opened on Broadway. So would you speak to his career and the rescuing of this motion picture?
Well, as you can probably tell at a glance, I bring somewhat of a different perspective to this panel. I was born in New York in 1934 and started going to Broadway shows only 4 years later. And one of the first shows I ever saw was an incredible musical that ran all of 1 week and actually featured Lynn's grandfather, Troy Brown. It was called Swingin' the Dream, and it was a radio station. And it was a sort of a swing version of A Midsummer Night's Dream with Denny Sullivan,
Butterfly
Jackie Mabley, Moms Mabley,
Butterfly
McQueen, they were all in it.
Nicodemus
was in it, everybody was in it. It was an incredible show, and I became fascinated by the excitement of watching black performers on a stage. It was something revelatory to me. And I began to grow up at the Museum of Modern Art and would see old movies. And of course, I would see many films in which Stepin Fetchit appeared because they would have John Ford retrospectives. And of course, we'd see all the films with Will Rogers. And I must tell you, with the candor, every time I saw Stepin Fetchit, I had this very conflicting response. He was terribly funny. And as I laughed, I felt guilty. Does that make any sense? Mm-hmm. And I thought, why am I feeling guilty when laughter is such a joyous experience? And I began to realize maybe I was feeling guilty because of a kind of imbalance in the image that Hollywood in the 30s projected about black people. I mean, they were either servants or they were comedians, but they were always depicted in a very negative way. And that made me very nervous, and I didn't like that feeling. And Stepin Fetchit was always a very shadowy figure to me. And in 1971, I was invited by the Museum of Modern Art to produce what turned out to be its lengthiest film retrospective up to that time. I called it The Roots of the American Musical Film, 1927-1932. And I showed 38 musicals and excerpts from many others where the film wasn't worth watching necessarily, but the musical numbers were. And I announced to the museum that I was determined to show Hearts in Dixie. Now, the first reaction on the staff the Museum of Modern Art was, oh, you can't show that, there'll be a race riot. And I thought, well, art should excite people. When Stravinsky began, people were responding with great hostility sometimes to Stravinsky, and now Stravinsky is completely mainstream. We understand and we accept. And sometimes people are shocked and respond very well. And I said, no, we're going to show Hearts in Dixie. So I ended up showing at least half the movies I showed were then the world's only nitrate known prints. And Fox tremulously sent out to New York what was believed to be, and probably was at the time, the world's only nitrate print of Hearts in Dixie. Well, the film was revelatory. First, because it was the first talking picture with an all-black cast. Everybody thinks, and a lot of historians erroneously say, that it was King Vidor's Hallelujah, but it wasn't. Hallelujah was the second. They almost overlapped, but Hallelujah came second. Hearts in Dixie definitely was the first. It went into production in 1928, when talkies were very new. The thing you discover about it is that unlike many early talking pictures, where it's almost like a stage production where people walk in and out of the image because it was so difficult to move the cameras. You know, if you saw Singing in the Rain, you know how that worked. Fox did not record its films on disc. When they recorded on disc, they had largely immobile cameras. But Fox used a sound on film system that they called movie tone, which meant wherever the camera was, the sound was being recorded simultaneously on the same strip of film as it was being shot. So Hearts in Dixie shot in 28 and early 29, is remarkably fluid. It looks like an almost modern film. It looks like a film that could have been made 10 years later. The sound recording is crisp. It is crisp and clear. And then there's the presence of two great black performers. The father, played by Clarence Mews, who is quite wonderful, maybe a little too large for the medium of film. Sometimes stage actors overact for the medium of film. They don't realize they can just sort of stand there and speak quietly and the camera does all the work. So sometimes stage actors, especially in early talkies, overdo it. But Stepin Fetchit was astonishing. And I brought along a copy of the original program notes that I wrote in 1971. And this is probably the first thing anybody wrote about Hearts and Dixie since 1929, because the film hadn't been seen. And I wrote, from the fancy stepping dancers and beautiful choristers to the disarming children, the entire cast is perfectly chosen. And I made a mistake. I thought it was his first movie. Forgive me, I was ignorant. In his first film role, not his first film role, Stepin Fetchit introduces his familiar characterization of the chronically indolent loafer. While this role grew so caricatured in later films that it began to offend in certain quarters, Fetchit's performance in Hearts and Dixie is a comic delight. His shuffling tap routine and rhythmic wood chopping song are so fresh, whimsical, and unusual for the time that it is easy to understand why the largely white movie-going audience of 1929 embraced him at once as a favorite. Well, what happened, of course, is that the caricature that he himself created grew, I think, more and more extreme as he was stylizing it. But in this film, it's irresistible, and I'm just hoping that one day Fox will have the courage to issue the film. And far from having a race riot, the Amsterdam Muse came down to the Museum of Modern Art and wrote a glowing review of Hearts and Dixie. And I just think it's important to put that into the hopper. As far as Showboat is concerned, Showboat was based on a 1926 novel by Edna Ferber, published by Doubleday. And at once, Jerome Kern acquired the stage rights to work with Oscar Hammerstein on the familiar musical that you all know. At the same time, Universal Pictures bought the movie rights. Now you have to remember, in 1926, there were no talkies. Nobody was talking about sound film. So the movie that Universal made wasn't even remotely based on what turned out to be the 1927 libretto created by Oscar Hammerstein. It was based on the novel. So it's very interesting to see the 1929 film version today, because what you're seeing is some of the same material, but developed in an entirely different manner. It was developed for the medium of silent film. They took so long to shoot it, however, in 1928, that by the time they were shooting, the world knew the Jerome Kern and Oscar Hammerstein stage version. So suddenly, this film became totally anachronous. And Universal had to make a deal with Ziegfeld, who produced the show, in order to get the rights to the Kern score. And they grafted it in. And they did it in a most uncomfortable fashion, because in a musical, when you're creating a libretto for a Broadway musical, you leave spots where the songs are going to help augment the story and develop the story. But no such moments existed in the movie, which told its story perfectly well in the medium of imagery, because it was a silent movie. So the sound of the 1929 Showboat, in which Stepin Fetchit plays the character of Joe, is very minimal. It's not a very big part. And the talkie version isn't particularly interesting, except as a chronological phenomenon, because they had what they called goat glands. You know, they would make a silent movie and they'd stick a talkie sequence in later, and they always referred to that as a goat gland. And people were injecting goat glands for alleged health purposes at that time. It was a big vote. But if you want to see the silent movie, which is much more beautiful, it doesn't have the interruption of all the talking picture sequences. And the silent film is very, very beautiful. And he's quite touching in his scenes in the silent version. It's not so easy, unfortunately, but I've been told that Warner Brothers, which now owns the film, is issuing a box set in 2007 because it will honor the anniversary of the Broadway opening in 1927. And I'm hoping maybe to work on that. So that explains something about Showboat?
Really well. Thank you.
Yeah,
thank you. Mel, I'd like to ask you. Lincoln Perry and Sidney Poitier were born 25 years ago. Both born in Florida, both born of Bahamian parents. Mr. Poitier, both of his parents are Bahamian. Bahamian and Jamaican, Lincoln Perry's parents.
Yeah.
How do you see, if at all, that Caribbean experience inform the life of Lincoln Perry?
Well, I touched on it briefly in the book. I went deeply into it. It seemed like kind of an aside, and I could not really confirm or verify. And since I wanted the biography to be basically authentic, I did not project too many theories about it. But certainly, I think there was much ado made about some conflict between the West Indian blacks and African American blacks. In fact, West Indian blacks at times were very critical of African American blacks for being too passive, for being not aggressive enough. And vice, and it was turned around the other way, where African Americans who were from this country looked at West Indians as being uppity and not understanding what the culture was about. So they wanted to know some people from the kids of blacks. And having witnessed part of this controversy, I think Harold Cruz talked about it a lot in Crisis in the Blue and Western Crisis. It's a big factor in it. What happens with some Caribbean blacks is that they didn't come to this scene with the same baggage that many African Americans who grew up came. They didn't grow up the same way. They were not taught by parents or grandparents who instilled in them a sense of what had gone on and the best way to act in order to get what you want, this sort of passive resistance, the kind of thing that Stepin Fetchit, as far as I'm concerned, part of his act was based on, is something that even for me, certainly for my parents, was ingrained into them. There was an understanding about how to treat white people, how to get around white people, how not to confront them, but to get what you wanted without confronting them. So it was a kind of passive, slippery kind of way that you approach whites in previous generations. Caribbeans, West Indians did not have that, did not see it as necessary, thought that you should be straightforward, demand what you wanted, and therefore their attitude about race and what to do with this country was quite different, I think. And you see that Bert Williams also can be added to people who have a different sense of what of how a performer could act, what he could do. And I think if we're talking about it psychologically, then there is a sense of a distance from the African-American image or the African-American persona that we all talk about, historians talk about when we're talking about the black experience in this country. There was a distance. They didn't see themselves as inferior in a way that some blacks in this country did. They didn't come with that baggage. They came with a sense of entitlement. They came with a sense that if I'm good enough to do this, I'll do it. And they were willing to take the consequences because they had not had the experience through their grandparents that just gone to keep them from doing it. So you had a different approach. And I think you see it with Bert Williams. I think you see it with Stepin Fetchit. I think you see it with Sidney Poitier. These people came into performing with a sense of, if I'm excellent at my craft, I can create a character, and it's a character. It has nothing to do with racial stereotypes or racial caricatures. Mm-hmm. It has to do with performance, with creating something that is art. And they came with that feel, and I think that's what sets them apart from many of the African American performers of the day. I think that's why Stepin Fetchit was able, or Lincoln Perry was able to take that character and push it to the studio limits that he finally pushed it to. I think that's why he's able to achieve something that when I watch his films, and I agree with you on the panel, they sometimes make you cringe. And I just recently, last one, saw Judge Priest, and there are scenes in that film that will make you cringe. On the other hand, the man is funny, the timing is impeccable, and when you watch it,
if you get away from looking at it from the eyes of the period and you say, well, right now, we can be anything we want to be, you can have a Stepin Fetchit or a Sha-na-na on TV with Martin Lawrence. You have a Big Mama.
Oh, Sha-na-na. Sha-na-na was certainly the other show.
What was the character, the player, whose name I've forgotten now, but that Martin Lawrence said also. You can have these characters now because you have enough characters that balance it. Truly black, you have a range of black characters on the screen and on television now that give you a full picture of what black people are like. Unfortunately, in movies right now, I would have to go back to some of the things that are happening in 50 Cent and some of the people I think were too much stuck in the hood right now. And people, the mainstream, tends to think that all blacks nowadays are either carrying guns, selling dope, with bolder lines about their own community. So, it's a very strange time, but this country, and if we get into it later on, we'll talk about it, it seems to me this country has always had one of two perceptions of black people. It's either been comic, the inept comic, or the immoral, brutish fool. So you have, you get it with Zip Coon back in the old days, who was there, you get it with Birth of a Nation, you had it with the two things that were presented there, the two various characters presented there. The good Negro, who's the Uncle Tom type, and the comic fool was there, and you also had the Roots.
Oh, yes.
And if you look through the history of blacks in performing arts, I think you always find one of the two black exploitation, black exploitation films. You had the Root, the sexually active and moral Root. You're always going between, the pendulum swings between these two extremes, as far as I'm concerned. With back in the Stepin Fetchit's time, or Lincoln Perry's time, you had Mantan Moreland, Billy Best, the Pig McMartin, and all of these people in the films, you were dealing with the comic, the fool, the coward. And it swung to another thing, obviously. So it's that basically is how I see this. But in terms of, again, getting back to your question, the West End heritage, I think that gave each of these actors the ability to step away from the baggage that most African Americans have, and I'm saying African Americans meaning people who grew up in this country, and had a Southern background. In the 40s, 90% of the African Americans in this country had a Southern background.
That's right. You know, I became very interested, I guess at the beginning of my life through all of my grandparents. My grandfather was 92 on the 7th of March, and he's my hero in life. And he worked in blackface as a child, as did my other grandfather, Troy Brown. So it's very interesting to have two grandfathers who worked in blackface. But what was interesting to me, my first film was a film called The Hollywood Shuffle. And I'll never forget when Robert Townsend took the picture to Europe. He was there, the press corps was present to have this wonderful dialogue with Robert about the film. And a man stood up in Paris and said to him, "Mr. Townsend, what is the state of the nigger in America?" Now, this is a part of the stunning recklessness and the real deep-seated ugliness of America advancing our image across the world. That he felt that he had a right and felt it was in order that he could use the word nigger, but would ask what the state of the nigger was. So this is a real ugly thing. I remember my grandmother talking very early on about working in pictures. As early as 1933, she did a picture called Jealousy with Nancy Carroll and the Nichols Brothers and others. But she came through at a time when she would tell me where the studio would, to widen her nose and other women, particularly and other men as well, they would put cotton on the ends of toothpicks to broaden their noses. And this is the kind of thing, that they had to endure. So what this man lived through, and the worst film personally I've ever seen in my life, was made by a black man who's very wealthy, allegedly an intellectual, and his name is Tony Brown. He made a film called White Girl, which is one of the most wretched films that God ever put in record. I mean, it's wretched Oedipus. And this was made today. And so I can tell you very candidly as an actor, I refused to work several times on Martin Lawrence's show, and I love Martin personally. But they always wanted to hire me as the literate brother who was white. They wanted to put upon him because he was literate. And so I would never take the job. So with that, Roscoe, for 32 years now, three people have played Gordon in the history of Sesame Street. certainly that is not, you made a picture that, that is still very popular among young people today within the black community, certainly called Willie Dynamite. I think it was 1973 or 1974. But you have dealt with, like LeVar Burton, and like others who have been on shows that really, really teach in the somewhat youthful dynamic of puppets and television, daytime television, morning television. You've been able to really hold forth with a very stellar image in that way. But would you speak to how you were impacted, again, in your sensibility, coming on to Sesame Street as early as, I think it was 1972?
Well, yeah, Sesame Street became a hallmark for children's television, in that it presented a whole new paradigm of imagery, kind of in an idealistic way, but for children to actually present those images that show a fullness of character, a true sense of community between various ethnicities, a real diversity for our children to emulate. I'd also like to just mention, in relationship to the question that now was the West Indian community, there's a line in the play, Matt's play, where Lincoln says, "I learned how to shuffle by watching American Negroes." And in fact, he did not know from firsthand what that was about, the shuffling tradition. It was a device of survival that was used dating back to slavery times, where the shuffling, clowning, grinning was used as a way of tricking white people and getting over. So Step, because of that distance that he had from that culture, he was able to see it and actually apply his artistry to it in a way that very few Americans have been able to, I think. So that's something that I've, in my research, character, I really tried to incorporate that kind of objectivity that he brought to the character that enabled him to then, as Miles said, even extend it into a stylistic form that was even beyond real. Really, that's I think what made it so hard for us to look at, because it was so grotesque in a way. It was so beyond anything that we could think of as normal or natural behavior. But it was extremely funny as well. Some of his asides that, you know, he would obviously be making up his own dialogue, because there's no white writer who could come up with any of those kinds of, you know, if you could listen close enough to hear some of what he was saying. And sometimes, you know, it was very difficult, but these were comments that obviously expressed the point of view of this character, who was really an oddity within the context of all of the films that he did for white Hollywood films. And he, with maybe the exception of films with Will Rogers, where there was really a real chemistry between those two characters. They really began, actually, it's probably the first black and white buddy movies.
Mel Gibson, Danny Glover.
Mel Gibson, Danny Glover, and so forth. Where there was that dynamic, Richard Pryor and Gene Wilder.
Stir Crazy, directed by Mr. Poitier.
Right. So Perry and Will Rogers really were the first of that genre, and in a very equal way as well. There's no doubt that Will Rogers respected Perry as an actor and as a person. And in fact, I could even detect there were moments in the film when Rogers was really working off of his rhythm. You know,
absolutely.
Judge Priest.
Yeah,
absolutely. Step would really set the tone, and Will Rogers would just kind of get into the groove with him.
Yeah, in fact, there were times when he was actually laughing. Laugh in character.
In character, and what Seth was doing. So, he really did bring an incredible, especially when you consider those times and the context in which he worked, an incredible sense of artistry and creativity to what he was doing. And then through Mel's book, I discovered for the first time that he had a whole other life outside of his acting life as a writer. He wrote a newspaper column in which he talked about and promoted his own career as well as others.
But also was critical.
And very critical.
Of things. Chicago
Defense Corps. Yeah. Yeah. So he was always pushing the envelope outside of, you know, his screen. He was also an advocate for change within the industry, always.
I think he also established himself as really one of the first major self-promoters in terms of the kind of self-promotion you now see. You've seen the Madonna, you've seen the people.
It took tremendous courage at that time.
Yeah. From what I understood, I never was able to authenticate this, but one other historian said that at some point, the reason he got the role in Parts and Dixie was that he took out a full-page ad in some nation newspaper saying that he was the best actor, the best black actor in Hollywood, and so on. He was doing this at a time when it was unheard of for black actors. Nobody would do this. For most anyone, because the studios took the public. But this man was promoting himself in a way that people picked up on later, and he fed on the controversy to a certain extent, his attitude in courtrooms and so forth. And again, I can't authenticate it, because you don't know, I don't know what he was thinking, and he didn't write about it. But it seems to me he knew what he was doing. He knew that the newspapers would be there. He knew he was going to be on the front page the next day. He knew how America reacted to the fact that when the judge did the wrong thing in court, or said something in court, he'd have to wake up and pretend that he'd done sleep. And the photographers were right there taking photos of him. He knew that that promoted his character. This is really ahead of his time.
Yeah, this may also have something to do with his very close friendship with two icons of American sport, Jack Johnson and Muhammad Ali, both very much in the same vein of self-promotion and logic in life that they created for themselves.
Yeah,
and he was very close to both of them, and they appreciated him.
You know, Roscoe, on that point, you know, it's interesting you're talking about images again. As a child, I always hated Black History Month. Personally, when I was very young, it was on the street, we did Black History Month because the images that I saw were very injurious. I saw water hoses turned on my people. I saw dogs turned loose on my people. And this was allegedly the month of celebration. So it was very injurious. And I recently interviewed the exquisite comic Timmy Rogers. Certainly appears in Mel's book. And Timmy Rogers talked about, he wrote a song called Dixie Necktie, Lynching. Richard Wright wrote eloquently about lynching. We see a book about sanctuary. It's very hurtful to watch it and to see it and to read it. So these images are real in every, you know, facet of society. So Professor Nunley, to that point, I feel we all agree that we have had an image problem from the time we were abducted and brought to this country. I think we still have an energy problem. What could you say to us that what might be the salve, if you will? Also, just to get into that, Howard Thurman, the great theologian, made one of the most profound comments I've ever read. He said, to die with your soul outraged and all the sensitive areas of your dignity destroyed. That is the plight of the poor. And so he talked about that, and he talked about not only the poor, but other things. But what would you suggest to us could be the salve for this wound that we've had from 1619 until the present? I know that's a big patch of time, but I regard your sensibility in this area.
I know you do, but this is why people don't like professors, because we think we can answer these questions. But I cannot say anything because my good friend and ex-roommate Ben is here. If I don't say anything, he'll talk about me all the rest of my life. So let me answer it this way, and I think it'll connect back to this issue of history that I brought up earlier. Right? I noticed, for instance, there's been discussion about I felt like we were injured, but we laughed. As if entertainment our laughter is somehow separated from social, economic, and political reality. And I would argue that they're always intertwined, mm-hmm. right? So Malcolm, right, famously said that if you don't stand for anything, if you don't stand for anything, you go for everything. So my question would be, to push the conversation in a little different direction, how do we hold African Americans responsible for the complicity in the very images that we critique, mm-hmm. right? So it is true that Stepin Fetchit was a trickster, he was tricking in certain ways. But we also understand it's part of the trickster tradition. It's tricksterism to what end? So if you think about Anase, a red rabbit, right? The signifying monkey, and shine. Mm-hmm. There was a tricking, but there was a tricking to, as Eric Lott talks about, to black uplift, as Ralph Ellison talked about, changing the yoke and slipping the yoke, right? The yoke of oppression. So I think you have to be a little more, so how do we become more astute about how we discuss these issues and don't pretend that images exist outside of history, that images don't do anything? Let me give you a prime example of what I mean by that. Now look, I'm not getting hung up in this discussion of whether if you say nigger or niggas, that you need to be banished from the edge of the earth. That's not what I'm talking about. But right now in San Jose, there are between 45 and 60 African-American kids who will have to deal with the authorities, either the high school authorities, college authorities, or the district attorney. Why? Because they're out in public or in school and some white kid called them a nigger. So what they do is they throw down and say, okay, this is it, right?
Get down where you get mad.
Right. You're getting with my fin. I'm a fin on your head, right?
Right, right.
So they hit the offending person. They go to the authorities, and the authorities say, no, 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 no. We're charging you with assault. Because the word nigger has been so promiscuously sold that it is no longer hate speech. Right? Therefore, that person is not wrong. You are wrong. You're getting suspended, et cetera, et cetera. And so, if Greg Tate in this book, Blackness Without Obligation, where he talks about Eminem peddling blackness and not being obligated to black culture. Mm-hmm. The question we also have to ask ourselves is, how can black folks engage in blackness without obligation? Yes, he was brilliant. Yes, there are a lot of brilliant African Americans who break through various barriers, but to what end? Mm-hmm. To their own end, to communal ends, and that sort of thing. And notice what I'm doing here. See, I'm saying it's both and. I'm not like trying to kick him to the curb,
yes.
right? But if we're going to say that he is a man of his time, then we could say the same thing about Strom Thurmond, right? And as a matter of fact, people are saying that about Strom Thurmond. As a matter of fact, because he happened to help two or three black people who he knew personally, he was still about to look for everything he did publicly, right? So for me, I don't know what we can do to solve the problem, but what we can do to be more sophisticated about the problem is to talk about both and. And so, in conclusion, that's why I loved his book. Because, look, like I said, for me, if I didn't read anything about Stepin Fetchit in my life, that would have been too soon. But because of his complex reading of Stepin Fetchit, of how he got both the good and the bad, how he had to wrestle to make it, to get in where he fit in, because we all got to do that, right? Right, I'm university. Right, so I'm complicit. I'm not teaching in my community center. Right. Yeah. So am I going to say I'm a sellout because of that? No, it's like, okay, Professor Nunley, what do you do with that complicity, right, and use it to other ways? And so a prime example of that would be the person you wrote about so well in the book would be Bill Robinson, right? He played in some roles that people, black folks, do not necessarily think were the greatest, but they all understood. They understood that he would take that money, help give it to black folk, participate in black politics, that sort of thing. So that's, for me, would be very important that we walked out of here understanding that entertainment is never just purely about pleasure, right? Because if it were, folks wouldn't be trying to hang Steven Spielberg right now with the movie Munich, right? No one is saying, that's just entertainment, right? For me, that's what I think all this is very important, because it makes this stuff complex, right? Because I got to sit up here next to a brother who's going to play the role, but my boss is going to say, well, that's a sellout. What are you trying to sell? That's ridiculous.
Right.
But on the other hand, I need to say, push, well, what about his obligation? What can what kind of effects did those kinds of performances create in terms of black folks' possibility for that sort of thing? So that's for me would be important.
Well, you know, it's very interesting because when we talk in present-day terms, and I'm going to turn it over to terms, and I'm going to turn it over to some Q&A now. But Professor, now that we talk about certainly R. Kelly presently and what he's facing in terms of criminal charges, but we see dominant culture get a pass. Strom Thurmond was a rapist. His daughter was born a rape. We look at this Roman Polanski, a fugitive from American justice. Mm-hmm. We honor him a war on film. Mm-hmm. And so we wouldn't get that pass, and I know that, and that's a part of the problem in terms of image and what is right. You know, he's a magnificent filmmaker, and so, you know, his raping a young woman at the home of Jack Nicholson, be damned. Mm-hmm. We're going to honor him with this great award. Mm-hmm. So, again, self-definition for me, how we're treating ourselves, what we're saying about ourselves. I mean, I just can't imagine that a $30 million campaign would go forward with the former head of Chrysler, Lee Iacocca, and Snoop Dogg. This is a man who was set on trial in downtown Los Angeles for murder, who would not have been allowed in the Chrysler building as even a courier when under his reign. But they would do a $30 million campaign with Bashizzle My Nizzle with Lee Iacocca. So this is staggering. This is part of it. And so I'd like to open this panel right now to any questions. Yes, at the back of the room, please. Oh. On your hand and then next to you.
Oh, okay. Lawrence Ross and my buddy M.K. Asante Jr. We're two of five black students in the graduate program for UCLA Film School for screenwriting. And we constantly, you know, have to, as we go through our characters and we create our characters, have to go through and make sure that, you know, we're not creating the next Soul Plane 2 and things like that. But one of the things that is kind of a conundrum in that as we go through and create characters and we look back at characters such as Stepin Fetchit is we wonder about whether or not when you look at a character, a comic character, such as like a Stepin Fetchit, and we look back and we say, is this at this point in time in 2006, should we look at Stepin Fetchit as being part of a comic tradition that is part of a lineage from Stepin Fetchit all the way up through Richard Pryor and then Ken on to modern day, and that therefore being a valid comic character that could be put inside of our scripts? Or should we look at it as being something that we say, well, it's a detrimental character because how it's going to be viewed by the community in the present day is a detriment. Which one do you look at? Because you could argue, if you looked at Stepin Fetchit now, you can argue and you can look at all the different aspects of it and say, well, maybe it wasn't as bad and maybe it wasn't as it's the same as a Milton Berle character in the early 50s dressing in drag. Maybe it's not that bad. But where do you guys stand on that, Mr. Watkins, first?
Well, first of all, in response actually to something you said a little bit earlier, I think we have to make a distinction between drama and comedy in terms of energy. Because drama is one thing, and it's very easy to determine if someone is presenting a detrimental image if you're dealing with a drama. If someone is a sniveling coward and he's portrayed as a black person in a drama, he's not going to laugh. He's simply portrayed as a black person. It becomes quite clear what you're seeing. Comedy always works for the other side. It's never what you see. It's about exaggeration. It's about laughing at something because you know it's not real. And Ralph Ellison, who we described a moment ago, said that himself. In fact, he said that ethnic humor in America was one of the cornerstones of this country because if we didn't laugh at each other, then we'd kill each other. He also said that you cannot laugh at anyone without seeing their humanity, because if you don't see the humanity, it's not funny. It's tragic. If someone falls down and you laugh at them, it's because, usually, it's because they're going to get back up and it's, oh, ha, 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 you fell down. So, but if a paraplegic falls down, you don't laugh. It's that simple. It's a matter of looking at comedy and looking at drama. And when you deal with comedy, you have to look at it a different way. You have to realize there's a double think going on, that I'm doing something, but what you're seeing me do is not real. Unfortunately, with black people in this country, because of the racism, because of the racial arrangement, we always pretend that what black comics are doing is somehow real. No one pretended that Milton Berle was a transvestite. No one thought of him as a transvestite. They may have laughed at his being, his breaking some social taboo, but no one accused him of being a transvestite. Stepin Fetchit was accused of being a toady and an Uncle Tom because of a character he played. Reality started to become involved with, to intertwine with performance. And it only happens with black people in America. And that's what we need to deal with, and that's what we have to see. If you're really going to do, and so my suggestion to someone making films is somehow, films have to be made so we get back to a reality that has nothing to do with the distorted image we get through racial lenses. Mm-hmm. When we're looking at things through racial lenses, there's always baggage, there's always distortion. If we accept ourselves as human beings where we should be going and get to the point where we can judge people on what they do, not on what they look like, then we're going to come up with a different impression. And it goes back to comedy. So, as far as I'm concerned, if you're dealing with comedy and you're making a film, you should be free to do whatever you want. Because any comic image is actually a performance. It's a joke about something. It makes you see something funny about that person. If you're dealing with drama, and if you're being serious, which is my objection to much of the stuff that's coming with the hood movies, it's not funny. It's supposed to be real. They're telling you this is real. So that line, that distinction, doesn't exist. That's a different, entirely different thing.
Before we go to Mr. Asante Jr., you'll be up next. I think Miles Kruger would like to comment on Mel's comment. Then
I would. As a theater and film historian, I run a library called the Institute of the American Musical, and we have thousands of recordings back to 1890, and many of them are comedy recordings. And one of the revelations to people nowadays when they discover these early 78s or wax cylinders is the intensity and the quantity of ethnic humor. I mean, there are Jewish comedians and Italian comedians and Irish comedians, black comedians, and so on. And they're performed by people who are, in a sense, using their own ethnos as a springboard for humor. But it's done without any embarrassment whatsoever. And in a curious way, as our society has matured, somehow we become embarrassed by that kind of humor. And we may have gained something, but we've also, I think rather sadly, lost something as well. And, I never knew much about Stepin Fetchit at all, except that I saw many of his movies. And I knew Carlo Van Vechten very well. He was the man who wrote a great deal about the so-called Harlem Renaissance, and through him, I met everybody in the world. I met Jimmy Baldwin and everybody. And no one ever talked about Stepin Fetchit. His name was never even raised. And I have to say that a week ago, when I began to read this remarkable book, it was revelatory to me. I mean, it's an incredible book. It makes this caricature that we've seen in movies for years into a three-dimensional thinking human being. It's superbly researched, and it's a terribly important book. I read biographies of performers all the time. There was a recent one about a female star, one of the great stars of the American musical theater. I won't be imprudent to tell you who the star is. And the biography is humiliating. It is so bad. I feel like Dr. Goebbels. Every copy should be burned because it's such a disgraceful book.
Miles, can I call the names that you won't?
But this is a great book.
Can I call the name that you wouldn't call?
Yeah.
The book is despicable. It's on the life of Ethel Merman. And it's completely and absolutely despicable. And this man masquerades as one who loves her and is a devotee of her. So, Miles, I think that you should burn your copy and purchase as many as you can and burn them. Professor, you were going to catch some of the comment, I think, on the comedy versus drama piece.
Yeah.
And then, Mr. Asante, I'm coming back. I want Mel
to
hear your question.
Thank you. Yes. Let me ask you a question directly. The fact that you're asking the question, so, and so if you wrestle with it, I think that will show itself in the work, because ultimately, right, it's about the scope of your work. And even some of my most favorite actors have been in roles that we might find to be somewhat questionable, right? So the question is important. Now, I understand what Mel was getting at. However, that's a very Aristotelian notion, right, of representation, right? So let me take the other side, Plato's side. Plato wanted to kick all artists out of the public. Why? Because Plato understood that although there's a separation between the person performing and what the character is doing, or the character, that representation does things in the world,
right?
So this brilliant Jerry Seinfeld, who I never watched the show because, you know, it's like black people don't exist in that world, but that's another issue, right? He did the credit card commercial where he went over to Europe, Britain, he started telling these jokes, and it didn't work, right? So he had to start going to these clubs, he had to start going to pubs, he had to get around with the people. Then he was able to tell jokes. Why? Because comedy, what is funny, is very much connected to culture. It's very much connected to experience. So don't tell me when I see Mr. Ryder do Mudbone, I'm not saying, that's my uncle, right? August Wilson put it very well when he said, look, popular art is about the rehearsal of the familiar, right? He was right. Art is about taking that familiar, defamiliarizing it, and helping us to see something a little different. And I would end with this, right? For me, I'm gonna throw you this great philosopher my grandmother threw on me. What's good for the gander, goose, is good for the gander. So if it's okay for you to do what you want to do, then when studio heads don't want to hire black folks for drama, it's okay, because they're doing what they want to do, right? When you can't see a dark-skinned black woman in a major role in the movie, don't complain, because guess what? It's about getting paid, it's about doing what you want to do. So notice, I'm not putting any requirements on artistic expression, because I'm all for art. But it seems to me that we have to think about art and popular culture in such a way so that at least we can say, what can you be held accountable for?
Right, right.
And if you can be held accountable for it, so can they. But if they can't be, neither can you. That's my way.
Mr. Asante, please. And you know, we can have other questions. I want Mel to be able to sign your books. We're here. We're going to wrap up punctually. But the questions can be asked thereafter.
Oh,
certainly.
Okay. I just said... I'd like to thank all of you for being here. This is an excellent panel, very informative. Like you said, you know, we're film students, and I'm really glad to be here. So I thank you for coming. I had a question, but then your response to his question made me think of another question. I'm reading Egri, the dramatist Egri, and he's talking. I'm reading the Art of Dramatic Writing,
right.
And you mentioned that we have to understand the difference between like comedy and drama. And Egri talks a lot about comedy and tragedy, and talks about the differences. And one of the things I remember, because I was thinking about last night, she says that comedy, you know, when events happen in comedy, you know, someone falls down, the thing that makes it a comedy rather than a tragedy is the implied pain. So that in pain, when you have pain, it's a tragedy. When you have, without pain, it's comedy. It seems to me that it's hard then to distinguish in such a divided country in terms of race relations when we're talking about drama and tragedy, I mean comedy and tragedy then, because what may be comic or comedic to one group of people may imply or have painful implications to another group of people.
Yeah.
So then it becomes all cloudy. I'm confused a little bit about that.
Well, I would also say that, it's not as simple as I put it. I was putting it that way to make a point. But obviously, take Richard Pryor, for instance. The reason Richard Pryor, as far as I'm concerned, is probably the best comic this country's ever seen, mm-hmm. is because he could take the comic and move it to the tragic,
right.
and move it
right.
to the comic. When you can do that, you become a genius. Right. If you're just a regular comic performer or a regular actor, you're a good one, but not a genius. You're not capable of doing that, and only a few people can do that. And yes, comedy can become tragic if you're Richard Pryor. In fact, there are times, and I say this in the book, and I really truly believe this, there are times that Stepin Fetchit, to me, becomes tragic in his performance. The comedy moves to the tragic, because he's touching on something that's so deep, so emotionally embedded in our souls. Images, fears, anxieties, as a black person, and as whites, I'm sure guilt is in some cases, or the feeling of what should I do, confusion, how do I react to this, all of these things are embodied in the comic, and therefore it makes it very complex. And while Stepin Fetchit was not Richard Pryor. Mm-hmm. Stepin Fetchit sometimes touched on that in his work. But yes, it is not clear, and you're right, and that's where you as a filmmaker have to be very sensitive to what you do and try to make it clear, to try to clarify for the viewer, the listener, depending on which you're working at.
A good example of all of this is animated cartoons.
Sure.
Where, you know, somebody falls off a cliff and they're splatted, and 2 minutes later, or not a minute, 1 second later, they're back. And they're three-dimensional, and they're alive again. People get run over by steamrollers and God knows what. And, you know, it happens to Bugs Bunny. If it happened to a real person and not Bugs Bunny, it would be a tragedy. But Bugs Bunny always springs back to life, and so that makes it very, very funny. And that's, I guess, an extreme example of the difference between tragedy and comedy.
Oh, yeah.
But before we go to this question, Mr. Asante, I just want to say to both of you, that I would really encourage you to go in the direction that your blood leads, and to hold on to your dignity and integrity and your core values. I would really encourage that in your writing, because in the beginning was the word, you know. And actors who are worth their salt, male and female, they're interested in the word first. Denzel can do the rogue cop in Training Day because his body of work allows it, and we don't have to look at him pejoratively. So that's what I would encourage. Yes, your question, and then I'd like to close.
Thank you. As the gentleman was just speaking about Bugs Bunny getting run over by a cement mixer, I thought to myself that the computer today would allow a human actor to get run over and be reconstituted. Mm-hmm. But what I wanted to ask you is there a compilation of all this stuff that's available on a disc that someone could see? All of this Black Minstrel stuff, all of the Stepin Fetchit stuff. Has anybody ever tried to compile it so that I could go to Netflix and look at it?
It's too vast for...
But a wonderful introduction to all of this would be Ethnic Notions, right?
Is that a film?
No, it's a documentary by Marlon Reyes. And it is, in my view, the best introduction to all the issues we've been talking about, the comedy, that sort of thing. It even intersects with Donald Vogel's Mammy's Times, that sort of thing. So that's a good way to start. But I think, like you said, it's just too fast.
Also, quite remarkably, in the last 3 weeks, a number of films been issued on DVD that are worth looking at. The Green Pastures, Warner Brothers, 1936, Hallelujah, 1929, MGM, directed by King Vidor, Stormy Weather, which is an absolute masterpiece, 1943 from Fox, and Cabin in the Sky, 1943. And the one that's missing is Hearts in Dixie, and it's just a pity that that hasn't come out yet, but I bet you sooner or later it will. And in that film, Stepin Fetchit really tears your heart apart because in the film, his wife and little child died. And suddenly this shuffling, you know, lazy comic character brings you to tears. And it's really, I think, well, you'd probably agree, it's the one example where he moves you the most in all of his motion pictures. And in Bend of the River, which he made in the 50s with Jimmy Stewart, the extreme character is gone. I mean, he's an assistant to the captain of a boat that goes up and down the river, a riverboat, and he's very touching. It's a very short part, but he's very touching in that movie, and it's a different Stepin Fetchit than the one that we associate with the Fox movies of the 1930s.
In fact, when I saw that movie, I was really appalled at the New York Times review. You were talking about this. I mean, he had to read that film at the time and just dismissed Stepin Fetchit.
Oh, I knew Buzz the Crowley. He was a jackass.
I knew him. I knew him also. He was retired when I got to the New York Times. But he still came in. But the fact is, I didn't see the movie for that reason, because I thought the movie was had to be negative and very stupid. And Stepin Fetchit at that time, when that movie came out, I mean, first of all, the movie came out, I was not even a teen. When it was available to me to see, I declined seeing it. And I really didn't see it until I started doing this book. And when I saw it, I found that, what's all the hoopla about? What is this about? This character that he's playing here, I could have seen on TV, on any sitcom that's on right now.
Yeah.
It's absolutely exaggerated. He put down at the end of that film, because they get along fine. He mumbles a little bit, but it's a buddy-buddy film again, where he's a buddy with the captain, they're talking about going down the river and having some more fun and so forth. There's absolutely nothing wrong with that role.
And they walk off arm in arm, like this, the white captain and Stepin Fetchit. And you have this tremendous sense that they're social equals, and it's just a wonderful feeling.
Well, you know, as we close today, I think that it's appropriate. Mr. Perry, if you would like to offer all of us a final word, I don't mean to be presumptuous, but if you'd like to do that, we would welcome your final word, sir.
But I'm not here to entertain. I've been entertained. Thanks to Mel Watkins and Gruber and Ran. I don't remember your name. Sorry.
That's okay. Dr. Nunley's
fine. You stated that what should we do to change the entire system since Stepin Fetchit was... He led the way for all blacks. He opened the door for all blacks, bar nobody else. And how did he do this? He improvised. If you notice, all his dialogue was improvisation, and he would step into every restraint that Negroes was not allowed to do. And in his day, to make your book more dimensional, which I want to acknowledge, I appreciate your services to me and this congregation. It's very invaluable. And you have my confirmation. But Stepin Fetchit, in his day, he must have been a phenomenal character as well as a great actor, because $7 million then is equivalent to $90 million today. That's what he made. So he wasn't no buffoon. He knew what he was doing, because every time I was with him, he would never mention show business. And he didn't want me to even begin, because it was too much life, too much hoopla. And he never played the piano. He never played the banjo. He never danced. That's another world. And that left me bound. But he told me, get into this field. And he never told me why. But he knew what he was saying. And he made an attempt to sue for the flagrancies of all, for the people, but God rest his soul, he couldn't. But he left me with nothing. He left me to either go to school, get into a college, and I didn't have the faith to give $50,000 to finish my curriculum, though I went to a junior college. But this man is no ordinary human being. He was intricate. Yes. Yeah. Because a lot of people, when I told them that, they said, how could one man make that much money? That one man made that himself. He was a realist. He was a natural, almost supernatural. And everybody knows this. That's why no one ever wrote a book about him or come to until now, except for Mr. Champ Clark in Chicago. He wanted to do it, and I said, you be my guest. But if you don't do it, I'll have to do it myself. And I don't know where to start. So I was sent $900. I haven't heard from him since. I wish I was able to call him now to be on this panel with you all. You might know him. He's a book writer. But I don't know whether he's finished it, or whether it's on the shelf, or whether he just shelved it.
Actually,
Mr. Mel Atkins, you should accomplish what you are thinking. How great was this man? Financially, materially, and mentally. He was beyond greatness. He was a superman of the divine mind, next to what God gave him and told him to do. Because all then was bliss. And he just said, well, ignorance was bliss. I thank you.
Mr. Perry, you have honored all of us with your presence, and most particularly your remarks. Your heart and your spirit are so warm and so impactful on all of us. I thank you so for being here and for offering those remarks. With those remarks, ladies and gentlemen, let me say good afternoon. Thank you all very much for coming. I'm hopeful that you would meet Mr. James Fugate over here to purchase a book and have it signed by Mr. Mel Watkins. And let us thank Mr. Miles Kruger.